is just look at the films that he's done, the stuff that he's acted in, and the stuff that he's directed. He has an extremely smart nose. If I leave a legacy of any kind, it's not going to be on film.
That's a good point. Maybe it's putting something back because you feel you've been blessed for whatever reasons. Paul was probably a pioneer in that, you know, when he started his business that could create profit to give to people.
A lot of it started because people would come to him and said, is this the way you want to go with this reputation of just being greedy, self-serving in your lifetime kind of thing? Or do you want to leave a heritage that, a legacy that is something more than that?
The whole nature of the food business was just going to be in it to have a lark and a boutique. But the second that someone said the only way you're going to make this work is to put your face on the label, that's the second the money went to charity.
Here's a ranch dressing where we dress them up as a cowboy. We have them as a Russian on our vodka sauce. We'd kind of take the actor and put him in different costumes and almost tongue-in-cheek make fun of Paul. Newman's Own started in 1982. Paul was, prior to that, distributing salad dressing to his neighbors. Salad dressing he actually made in his kitchen. His family would go out prior to the holidays and sing Christmas carols, and they would hand out salad dressing. After a period of time, all the neighbors would clamor for more salad dressing, so Paul said, okay, we're going to put it on the shelves of stores in Westport. When the company first started, what was in here was pool furniture from Paul's swimming pool, because the company was started in the fall of the year, and Paul brought all the furniture in here because he never thought the company would really last, so he figured he'd buy the furniture. And it stayed here for about 18 years. When I first started with the company, Paul pointed out that if we ever have a plan, we're screwed.
We went through a lot of tests trying to find out whether the actual product was worth putting on the market. We were finally told, you can't have restraint of trade. Once it goes to a single market, you can't stop somebody else from buying it. So it just, we made a profit, I think, our very first year, which was extraordinary.
Everybody grab a fork here.
Dig in. He was very involved in tasting all the products, in the formulation of products.
Let's not make any comments about these.
Enough.
Vote early and vote often.
He can taste product and pick up things that some of us can't.
Did we already count the votes?
Number four.
Right.
See, if they did the Academy Awards this way, it would have turned out different.
What really intrigues me is all this formula for business. I'm kind of an anti-formula guy. I think you are too. When you go out of the box, you do something different, and then you get the analytical stuff. No, it's not going to work because it doesn't fit that formula. And then it does work because you made it personal. You made it your own thing. You say, well, I'm going to just do it the way I want to do it. I love that.
These things have a mind of their own. You know, you think you're in control of them, and somehow you're not.
When you start something fun and you do it on a kind of lark, you want to keep the fun going. You know, you want to keep the fun going. Well, yeah, I mean, that's probably my best compliment to you. But the business, I don't know what it's doing. It's
obviously keep it lean, you know, for a company that's $160, $170 million a year company. We've got 18 people working for us.
Well, that's great. I'm making $18 and I have 160 million people working for me. But I'll tell you what I like, what I respond to, is that the humor that started it has never flagged.
But that's the delight of it. For instance, would you put your face on a can of dog food?
Huh? Dog shit, maybe, not dog food, no.
So Ann and I were walking down 10th Avenue, and there's a little pet shop, and I just went in to get something, and this lady kept looking at me, and she said, I think we have a picture of you in the back room. I said, is it on a can of dog food? She said, yes, it is.
He's a generous man who brings the gift of giving to each day, and he never asks for reward or recognition. One of the projects is a summer camp for children with life-threatening illnesses that they built in Connecticut in 1986.
How many camps are in existence now?
We have five in the United States. We have one in Ireland, one in France, one in the south of England. We have several little safari camps in Botswana and Zambia. We'll have a camp in South Africa. I think this year we had 13,000 kids in camp, all of it free. Kids have their childhood taken away from them by these life-threatening diseases or living under life-threatening conditions. I don't know how any of us can explain the luck that exists in our life. I can't believe the amount of luck, good fortune that's befallen me. So why not give back a little bit to the people who made you successful to begin with?
Jump first.
No.
Then you jump first.
No, I said.
What's the matter with you?
I can't swim.
Why, are you crazy? The fall will probably kill you.
Acting was something that I was supposed to do, to get through the day. The other stuff is stuff that I wasn't supposed to do. And that's the kind of stuff that you pay most attention to.
You know what this reminds me of? A theater. It has its audience, its cast, drama, comedy, and sometimes it's tragedy, too.
I started racing when I was 47.
I started out very slowly and very badly.
I still don't think of myself as being a spectacular driver, and I really wasn't.
Remember I had the 904? And we drove up to my place, and we were doing Butch Cassidy, and you oh man, and you got behind that wheel. And I said, here, why don't you try it? And next thing you know, you're in the Bondurant school, and then boom, just launched like a rocket ship.
Racing is about feeling it in the seat of your pants, just instinctively knowing what the limits of the car are and being able to drive at those limits for 2 or 3 hours at a time.
What was it that took you out of the pack of Le Pro? What kind of discipline?
I get hooked on something like that and I'm just a terrier and I try to go after it until I lick it.
What were the tough spots as you were getting there?
Going fast. Racers are great athletes. Most of the public, they don't realize what an athlete you've got to be to horse around these cars. When you're performing all the time or when you're in the public eye, if you take the kind of pressure that's on you, when you get out to that track and you sit down in that car, whatever it is that's roiling around your head, it just goes right out the window.
What is the mystique about beating the other guy, about winning? Whatever it is, it's a mystique that's held in high reverence by people in racing because they know it could all be gone tomorrow.
It's going to be very hard to quit, but at some point you lose your endurance. Boy, in the middle of July and it's 130, 140 degrees in that car, I'll tell you, takes it out of you pretty quickly. I became an owner because I thought I would be giving up driving in the early 80s. Didn't turn out that way. I can't be competitive as an actor. I don't know how do you compete? One guy is playing Uncle Willie, the other guy is playing Hamlet. So how do you say which performance is best? In a car, it's very simple. It's down to a thousandth of a second. I did win 4 SCCA national championships, which I felt very good about. Probably better about that than any acting awards that I've gotten.